Let us start for today. The first thing we will do today is to complete the analysis of wavelets. And since it's 2 weeks ago that we discussed it last time, I'll start by giving a little bit more details than usually about what we did so far. So the first part of it is just a repetition. So as you remember, everything in wavelet analysis is based on the multi-resolution analysis. So the important thing to know about the multi-resolution analysis is that it is generated just by the choice of a specific function phi. So we know that a multi-resolution analysis is determined just by the choice of one function. So this is the function that we usually just call phi. And the question is, how can we choose this function? And we have a very good answer to that question. We solved a theorem last time, theorem 8.211. So let me just remind you how this looked like, because you'll need it again today for the exercises. So what it says is that in order to construct a multi-resolution analysis, we have to find this special function phi, and we can just take it such that if you look at the Fourier transform in absolute value, then it should be positive in a small neighborhood around zero. This is one of the conditions. The second condition is what we call the scaling equation. Looking at the Fourier transform in 2 gamma should be equal to some one periodic function times the Fourier transform just evaluated at gamma. And the third condition is that the translate of the phi is an autonorm system. So you remember, from the definition of a multi-resolution analysis, we already have this as one of the conditions. This is the condition 5 in the definition of a multi-resolution analysis. So this is the only one of the 5 conditions we have in the definition that actually survive in this theorem. The conditions 1, 2, 3, and 4 are then replaced by condition 1 and condition 2, two conditions that only have to do with the function phi. So, looking at this theorem, we find out how to choose this function. And the good thing is, as soon as we have the phi, we know how to construct our wavelet. So this is something we can describe on just one blackboard. So there are a couple of steps we have to go through. One of them is that we choose exactly this function h0 that satisfies the scaling equation. So we choose h0, and this is important, this should be a one-periodic function. So we choose this function such that when we look at the Fourier transform of phi into gamma, this is equal to h0 of gamma times phi hat of gamma. This is the first step. After doing that, we introduce another function, namely the function h1 of gamma. And the way we define this, we saw that last time, is we simply take h0 of gamma plus a half. We complex conjugate the number that comes out, and we multiply with e to the minus 2 pi I gamma. And after doing that, we can define the wavelet. And the way we define it is by saying we want that the Fourier transform evaluated at 2 gamma is equal to this new function, h1 of gamma, times phi hat of gamma. So everything on this side is something we can calculate, and then somehow we just take the inverse Fourier transform and get rid of the factor of 2, and then the function side that comes out that way, this is our wavelet. So we know this. This is what we already have seen. So if you do this, then psi is a wavelet. And what does it mean that it is a wavelet? This simply means that if you look at the collection of all functions, all the scales d to the power j composed with all the translates tk acting on this function, where j and k run through all the integers, then this set will be an orthonorm basis for L2 of R. Then, at the end of the last lecture, we saw something slightly surprising, namely that now we have worked very hard to construct this wavelet, that means to construct this orthonorm basis. But then it is not even this orthonorm basis that we apply in practice. We apply another orthonorm basis. So instead, we will use the orthonormal basis given by the collection of all translates of phi, where k run through the integers, combined with not all the functions that are here, but some of them. So what we do is to say, instead of letting j run through all the integers, we start with j equal to 1, j equal to 2, and so on. So we take d to the power j, tk psi, and now just for j larger than or equal to 1, but still for k running through the integers. And that this system is actually an orthonorm basis, this is also stated in the book. This is the proposition 8-2-6. And what we want to do now, we did it last time, but now we will do it again, is to write down what does it mean that we have, that this collection is an orthonorm basis. This means that we can take arbitrary elements in L2, and we can expand it as infinite linear combinations of these elements. So what we get out here is that if you take any element f in the space L2, it can be written as the sum over k in C, and then somehow we first have to run through inner product between f and the elements that are stated here, and then multiply with the elements in the orthonorm basis. And then we do exactly the same with the elements that are stated here. So we get plus the sum j equals 1 to infinity, the sum over k in C. And then again, we get the inner product between f and then the elements in the basis, d to the power j tk psi, and then times d to the power j tk psi. And we will actually use this many times today. So I'll put in the number in the book for that equation. So what we did last time was to apply this in a very special case. We looked at an example. And in this example, we took a particular choice for the function phi and for the function psi. And these choices were exactly the one you worked with in the exercises. So we took the function phi to be the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1. And then it turned out that the corresponding wavelet would be the characteristic function for the interval 0 to 1/2 minus the characteristic function for the interval 1/2 up to 1. And then you could see in the exercises, and we did something also in the lecture, we could see that with exactly this choice, we got some very good approximation theoretic properties. So what came out of this with this choice, we could see that if you looked at some natural signals, and when I say natural signals, I actually think in terms of images. I think in terms of this kindergarten image that I made for you. When you look at images of that type, you can see that a lot of these coefficients actually turns out to be very small, meaning that we can throw them away, and then we get a very good representation of our image, but in terms of much fewer coefficients. So what we saw is that with exactly this choice, then whenever we're looking at natural signals, And when I say natural signals, I really mean just the example we looked at. So this means images. So for natural signals, many of the coefficients that appear here, the coefficients here, these inner products, turns out to be small. So the coefficients are these inner product f d to the power j t k psi, appearing in our formula. Many of them are small. And this actually gives a very efficient compression. And the way we obtain the compression is simply by taking all these small coefficients and throw them away, in the sense that we put in zero instead of the small coefficients. So somehow this explains for you why wavelets are a good idea. But there's one thing that it does not explain, namely, why do we have to spend so much time on the wavelet? Because exactly the example we are speaking about here is the Haar wavelet, which is about 100 years old now. So why did we have to go back and look at the wavelet theory in the beginning of the 80s? This is something that I have not explained to you yet. And this is exactly what we'll do now. And it turns out that even though in this example we can see that many of the coefficients here are small, it turns out that we can do something even better by using the flexibility of wavelets. By constructing some other wavelets, we are able to get even more of these coefficients to be small. That means we get some wavelets that are even better for applications. And this is the point we should deal with now. So if you should formulate it in just a few words, we could say that we have a goal now. And the goal is to obtain even more efficient compression. And you will see, we actually just need to take a few steps in order to reach this goal. So what we'll do is to introduce a technical condition that you have not seen before. Actually, you have seen it because there was an exercise on the program last week about vanishing moment. And I didn't speak about vanishing moment at the lecture, but I'll do it now, and then suddenly this exercise will make more sense for you. So we need a technical tool. And this is the definition of the vanishing moment. So what we do in this definition is simply to pick a function. At the beginning, we do not say anything about this function be a wavelet or not, but since I use the psi as name for the function, it's more or less clear that we are speaking about the function that should play the role of a wavelet later. So we just take some function psi in L2, and then we put some assumptions. So let's just write the assumptions down in a compressed form. So the assumption means that we are looking at some integrals from minus infinity to infinity. And basically, what we want to integrate is just psi of x dx. And actually, what we hope is that this integral will be zero. And if this integral is zero, then we will try to multiply the function with the x and also hope that this integral is equal to zero. And if this works, we multiply with x to the power 2 and hope that this integral is zero. And we continue until we get something that is non-zero. And the short mathematical way to formulate that is that we are looking at integrals of the form x to the power l times psi of x dx. And the assumption is that this integral is equal to zero for some values of L. And what we'll do is to start with L equal to zero. If this works, we go to L equal to 1. If this works, we go to L equal to 2, and so on. So the assumption is that these integrals R0 for L equal to 0. And for L equal to 0, this really means that we just look at the integral of the function psi itself. If this is not satisfied, then we cannot use this definition for anything, and we just stop. But if this is satisfied, then we go to the next value of L. So then we look at x, and this will just be x to the power 1. So we look at x psi of x, integrate, and hope that this is equal to 0. And we continue like this. So the assumption is we get 0 for L equal to 0, 1, up to some place where it does not work anymore. And this place will be denoted by a number n minus 1. If this is the case, then we say that psi has n vanishing moments. So this is the new terminology. So you might wonder, why do we say that it should hold for L equal to 0, 1, up to n minus 1? The reason for this is that if we stop here by n minus 1, then you see we have exactly n values here, because we also have the 0 value. So then we have n altogether, and this is why we say n vanishing moments together. So n vanishing moment simply means that the first n of the integrals we are looking at, all of them will be equal to 0. The Danish word is almost the same. It is forsvindende momenter. So how does this look like in practice? You had an exercise last week where you looked at exactly the Haar wavelet. So if you make a small figure of that function, you know, it looks like this, goes like this, and then down like this, and then it is 0 on the rest of the interval. So you can see, actually, you get an integral that is 0 if you put in L equal to 0, because for L equal to 0, you just get the integral of the function itself. And if you integrate this function, this is because it has the same amount here as it has here, then the integral will be equal to 0. But then already, if you take this function and you multiply it with an x, so already, if you do this for L equal to 1, then you get an integral that is non-zero. That means for this function, you only have one vanishing moment. So for this function, we have n equal to 1. So now, what I have to explain to you is, what will these vanishing moments do for us? And this is what you'll see right away in the theorem that we write down now. So, here, let's connect it with the wavelet analysis. So let's say we take a function psi, and now this should be a wavelet. Actually, this is not strictly necessary for the theorem, but we want to apply the theorem for a wavelet. So we take a wavelet, and we assume that it has compact support. This is definitely something we want for practical applications, so this is not a problem to put this assumption. And let's assume that we have n vanishing moments. Then our goal is to analyze a given function f. So now when I write f, you should think about f playing the role of this arbitrary function in L2, which we have expanded this way. So we take a function f belonging to L2. And then we put some assumptions which, when you see them first time, you'll think that they look a little bit strange, but let us put them anyway. So what we'll do is to assume that f actually is n times differentiable. So before I move on with the theorem, let's think a little bit about what does it mean that that the function is n times differentiable. We think about n as a relatively higher number, so maybe n is 5 or 10 or something like that. So what we are dealing with is a function that is 5 or 10 times differentiable. What this means is that the function is actually very smooth. It's not something that has a lot of edges. It is running very smoothly. So, if you think about what we want to do at the end, we want to do compression at the end. So if you think about this little kindergarten picture again, so I'll not put as many details as last time, but let's just make it like this and say we are looking at a certain row in this picture, because you know we are doing the analysis row by row. So if you think about this row, then the part of this row where the signal is very smooth, that's exactly here between the tree and the house, because as I said last time, this is probably just a fence. We have here a fence with the same color, so there are not many changes here. It's a function that is very, very smooth on this piece. It is not smooth at the boundary to the tree, it is not smooth to the boundary of the house, but on this part it is smooth, and then again inside the house it is very smooth, and inside the tree it is also smooth. So what I'm speaking about here with this assumption of being n times differentiable being smooth, this is exactly, for example, the part we are on here. So this is the part where we know from our argument last week or 2 weeks ago that actually many of the coefficients are small. But now we can do something that is even better than we did last week. Then the result says there is a constant. C, which is positive, such that, and what we want to estimate will be exactly the coefficients that appear in our expansion 814. So we are looking at exactly the size of these inner product F with D to the power J T K psi. We want to know how big these numbers are, so we look at them in absolute value, and what the statement says is what comes out here is smaller than or equal to this fixed constant C times e to, not e, but 2 to the minus j n times 2 to the minus j divided by 2. And this holds for all values of k, and this holds for all value of j that, that are greater than or equal to 1. So what does this mean for us? Can any of you explain where are we heading now? Why is this estimate interesting for us? Dario?
Because when n is large, that means that the coefficients are small, and so I can cut off some of the coefficients, I can store less coefficients if I want to reconstruct the image.
So you say many of the coefficients are getting small.
Yeah.
This is true. The coefficients that we have here are exactly the coefficients that appear here. And what we see is we can estimate how many of these coefficients are small, because this is smaller than a certain constant times 2 to the minus j times n times 2 to the minus j divided by 2. So what we see here is if we put in n equal to 1, for example, for n equal to 1, this term is just 2 to the minus j, which is something that goes to 0, but it goes quite slowly to 0. But if you put in n equal to 100, then these numbers, they will be extremely small, even for small values of j. That means we just need to go to j equal to 2, 3, or something like that, then all of them will be extremely small, and we can just replace them by 0. Let's write down a concrete example. So let's say we look at n equal to 10. I did some calculations. So I looked at 2 to the minus j n. How big is this number? And actually, I just calculated for j equal to 1 and j equal to 2. And already for j equal to 1, we get something like 10 to the minus 3, which is a quite small number. Maybe it is not small enough that we actually allow to throw it away, but then by going to j equal to 2, actually we get 10 to the minus 6. And if you continue, you go to j equal to 3, you get 10 to the minus 9, and so on. So you can see already if you have 10 vanishing moments, then these numbers will be extremely small, meaning that these numbers, the coefficients, will be extremely small. So the interpretation of this is that if you have a large number of vanishing moments, then we actually get many very small coefficients. And this gives us very good approximation properties. So either you say approximation properties or very good compression properties. So maybe, as you are looking at this, you feel that if you are doing it this way, with a high number of vanishing moments, everything will disappear, because I did this estimate. So is it true that everything will disappear? Will all coefficients be small and we can just throw them away? Hopefully not, because if this is true, then the image is just deleted. So, Matthias? We take the function such that it has a high number of vanishing moments, but we only get that the coefficients disappear when this assumption is satisfied. That means it's only the coefficients corresponding to parts of the signal where the function is very smooth. They will disappear, but the places where we had edges, for example, here and here and so on, these places, the coefficients that are sitting there, they are not getting small, so we will keep them, but it's just on all the places here, for example, inside the fence, inside the tree, inside the house, and so on. The coefficients there, we can just throw them away, but we keep coefficients at the edges. So now you see the argument for getting a high number of vanishing moments, and you also see the explanation why we are giving this lecture, why we are not satisfied with the Haar wavelet. And the reason is, of course, as you saw here, that for the Haar wavelet, we simply had n equal to 1, that means we had the smallest possible number of vanishing moments. So we want to do something that is better than this. And this is exactly the point where we had this breakthrough that I have explained to you a couple of times. So I didn't do it in so much detail because you did not understand so much at this time, but the breakthrough by Dobbachy so in 88, she was able to show that no matter which value of n you give her, she can actually construct a corresponding wavelet. So she could show that for any natural number n, there's a wavelet with, and it had two very good properties. First one, as I said many times, and we even stated it here in the theorem, that in order to do something in practice, you need the compact support. So what she got out is that this wavelet has compact support, and she can even tell exactly how big is the support. So it turns out, maybe you can see that intuitively. If you want better properties, if you want more vanishing moment, you somehow have to pay a price for that. And it turns out that the price you have to pay is that the support is getting larger. It depends on the n. So if you want to do it with a high number of vanishing moments, you get larger support. So she showed that you can get it with support on the interval from 0 up to 2n minus 1. And then the second property is that it has n vanishing moments. So that means No matter which value of n we are looking at, we can do what is going on in this theorem. We can obtain this very good compression rate that is stated here. And then you can just imagine how this would look like if you put in n equal to 100, for example, or n equal to 1,000. This will just, everything will just die out, except at the places where something happened in the image. But the price to pay is you get a very large support if you do it with n equal to 1,000, of course. So let me show you how these functions look like. So I have two images. The first one is what you get for n equal to 1, sorry, for n equal to 2. It turns out if you do it with n equal to 1, then the Dobezhy wavelet will give exactly the Haar wavelet. So the very first one of the Dobezhy wavelets, this is exactly the one we have been speaking about all the time. So the first interesting case is when you look at n equal to 2, and then you get this very irregular function that is stated here. It is not even differentiable. It's a very strange function. And for n equal to 4, you get something that is at least a couple of times differentiable. And actually, if you look closely at these images, you can see that the support, you can see the support from these figures, you can see that this corresponds exactly to what is stated here. The strange thing about these functions is you cannot find a function expression for them. So usually if you have a function like the exponential function, you have an expression where you can just put in your x and then a function value comes out. You don't have any function expression for these. So what happened is, if people want to calculate function values of these functions, they have to do some algorithms that will stepwise approximate the correct function value. So you don't have that they are equal to just sine of e to the x times something. It is impossible to write them like this. So they are very, very special functions. Now, before we leave the wavelets, I would like to say just a few words of applications. So I'll just briefly mention some of the applications of the wavelets. One of them is, again, something that we have touched, but we did not go into details with it. But this is about FBI that stores a lot of fingerprint. And it turns out that they actually store the fingerprint via wavelets. So the way you should understand this statement, let's look at a fingerprint. So the way you look at it is, again, that taking any fingerprint will correspond to a small image. And then you can store this image digitally. And this is done using the wavelet. The compression of this image is done via the wavelets. And there's actually a story connected to this. Because if you go back to 1995, the way FBI had stored all their fingerprints were on small finger card, on the small paper cards. So this means they had 30 million people in their archive, and they were just stored like small paper cards of this type. And this means all of them were in Washington. If somebody did something in San Francisco, they had to mail the fingerprint to Washington, and somebody had to go down in this basement, this top secret basement where they had all these fingerprints, and then he had to run through all these 30 million fingerprint to find the right one. And of course, this did not work. So a lot of criminals, they just got free because they didn't find the correct fingerprint on time. So FBI actually made a competition where they say, who can take this databases and find a way to store it electronically and compress it such that we will have an efficient algorithm to find the right fingerprints in the database. And it was Wavelet that won this competition. And since then, FBI has actually used the wavelets in order to store the fingerprints. And it turns out that it worked very well. So just within the first year after they got this information on the electronic form, they actually caught something like 800 criminals that had been running around for years. So they gave up finding these 800 people. But because now they could find the right match in the archive, then they could catch them easily. So it was very efficient to get it. And then you might ask, could we have done it without wavelets? And it turned out, of course, there are other ways to compress signals. So maybe you could have done it without wavelets. But you needed to do some compressions, because if you have 30 million fingerprints, if you just transfer this into digital images, then you'll get a data set that is so large that you can simply not handle it by any computer. And in fact, now I always speak about these 30 million fingerprints. Actually, they did not have 30 million, they had 300 million, because they always take fingerprints of all 10 fingers. So they had 300 million fingerprints that they stored on these paper cards. So it was necessary to do some compression in order to make it work. So this was really the breakthrough for wavelets in applications, that they could do this. And then after that, it is not a surprise what the next step will be, because you know there are all these standards for digital images. There are the JPEG, for example, JPEG 2000. And because of this story, then wavelets got implemented in this. So whenever you're making a digital picture, then you are automatically using the wavelets. There are more applications of this. Actually, also, if you play some music with an MP3 player, then again, there are wavelets incorporated in the compression methods there. And this is very much related to the last application I want to mention for you, because wavelets actually turn out to be extremely good at noise reduction. And actually, if you look a little bit at this expansion we have here, you can more or less understand what is going on, because what you have here, all the functions that are stated here, they have the form 2 to the j to the power 2 to the power j divided by 2 times psi of 2 to the power j x minus k. So if you make some pictures of these functions for different values of j, you can get a very good intuition saying that the high frequency part of the signals will be contained in the part having large values of j. And this means in practice that if you look at this sum where you are running through all scales from j equal to 1 up to infinity, if you cut this off maybe at n equal to 200 or something like that, then you're actually cutting off frequencies from a certain place and then onwards. So cutting off this, making this into a finite sum, means that you are cutting the high frequency components of your signals. And actually, if you think about a recording, for example, these LP recordings or something like that, the noise that appears on such recording is always high frequency. This means that if you look at this kind of signals and you cut the representation at a certain place here, what you're cutting is more or less the noise. You might also cut some of the signal. You cannot avoid that. But at least you are cutting more of the noise. That means you will get the impression that the recording you listen to is more clean than it was before. And there's an extremely good case that actually explains the role of wavelets in that. So I will show you a picture that you have probably not expected to see today. So I guess only few of you will know what it is. Of course, it's a piano. But this is actually a recording studio as well. So you can see it goes back to 1890. And what happened is, while somebody were playing here, there was this piece of paper sitting here that was running through the piano. You can see it here in a larger version. So what happened is, somebody hit the key on the piano, and then you know there's this hammer going up and hitting the string. And then at the same time, this hammer was hitting the paper. And then it made some holes in the paper. And then you see, when the paper runs through the piano at the same time, what comes out is a piece of paper with a lot of holes, and these holes actually describe the music. So what people could do after that is to put in this piece of paper in the piano again, and then get somebody to turn around, and then the piano would actually play the music again. So this is the way they made recordings 120 years ago. And there was, in particular, one composer that used this to record some of his own music. So Johannes Brahms actually composed some music, and he recorded it this way. The problem is that then it was stored on these small pieces of paper, and actually you can see how they look like. So what comes out is actually something, it looks like a cartoon of milk. So you see there's something like 20 or 30 of them just put next to each other here. So each of these boxes with a weight of maybe 1-2 kilo, they contains 5 minutes music. But Brahms, he recorded his music on pieces like this, and the problem is it gives a lot of noise. So some people took the recording from these pianos and put them on LP players. And then some years ago, 10 years ago, there were some music researchers, they wanted to listen to these LP recordings to find out how he played his own music. But there was so much noise that they could actually not recognize how he played it. They could not even recognize that he played on a piano. So it was completely useless. So what people did, they took these wavelet algorithms. They took this representation we have here and they threw away the large coefficients. And then suddenly they could hear exactly what he was playing. So they could remove so much noise that they found out exactly what the music was. And then you can see the surprise was that what he was actually supposed to play, what he has composed himself, is something that goes like this. Maybe you don't understand how to read a score, but you can see this is something with frequencies that goes up. So this is somehow you're going to the discant in the piano. But what he actually played is something that is here. And whether you understand the score or not, you can see that what he played has nothing to do with what he actually wrote down on the paper himself. So what this tells is that 120 years ago, when people composed something, it is not like today that they write something and you have to play exactly what is stated. So what they did at this time was to compose something like this, and then when you actually go to a concert and you play it, you just get inspired by this and you play something that more or less gives the same feeling as what was in the score. So if Brahms came to the conservatory today and he wanted to start as a student, he would reach exactly this point and then they'll say, thank you, you please go out. They will not let him in today. But what this story says is the music was written in a different way. It was intended a different way than we think about it today. And of course, this sounds like something that is far away from Mathematics 4, but you can see the discovery of this was actually based on wavelets. It was based on this very heavy Mathematics 4 stuff that we have here. So this is just one example, and I think by now you understand that wavelets are efficient for noise reduction. When you can get this kind of information out of something where you cannot even hear that it is a piano, then it must be very efficient. So what we'll do now is to take our break for today, and we'll begin the next hour by something that is apparently completely different, because we'll speak about B-splines. But then at the end of next lecture, you'll find out that there's a reason that we start a lecture just with wavelets and end with B-splines, because what you'll do at the problem session today is to show that B-splines actually, some modifications of the B-splines will give some very good wavelets as well. So everything turns out to be connected at the end. So let's take our break now.